Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for being here this afternoon. What we're doing is that we're having budget consultations throughout Fiji. We've had public consultations in a number of towns and cities. We also started off with the schools today. This morning we were in Vashishmuni School in Navua. So all the schools in the Serua Namosi area were all present. As far as Korovislo, down going towards Nanonga, then of course we have people up from the Namosi Hills, we've got a few schools there. I understand there's about 27 schools present here this afternoon. So thank you for making the time and being here. As part of the budget consultations last year, we actually had a set of consultations that were held here in this very hall, where we had schools from the central division that came along, and we had consultation in Lambasa, schools in Manolevu, and one in Natabua, where we had schools from the Western Division. Because of the huge level of interest, we decided to actually have now these consultations for the schools in all the towns and cities. So, you know, we've got one in Suva, today we were in Navua, tomorrow we are in Nasori. On Wednesday, we are in Singatoka at Singatoka Methodist, in the afternoon at Swami Vivekananda College for the Nandi area. And then on Thursday at Natambua High School for the Lotoka area, in the afternoon at Xavier College for the Ba area. And then in a few weeks' time, we're going to other areas too. 69.4% of the population is below the age of 40 in Fijian. So 69.4% of all Fijians in Fiji are below the age of 40. So you people are in the majority. Most of your teachers who are over the age of 40 are in the minority. So it is therefore very important for us to be able to hear your views in respect of the economy, but more importantly, hear your views in respect of how government should formulate the budget. The budget, of course, as you know, is a very important piece of document. I feel a bit awkward standing up there, so I'll stand here. The budget is a very important piece of document because it sets out government's expenditure and revenue collection for the year. It sets out government's priorities in the areas that government will spend money in. So as part of the consultations, apart from hearing your views, we actually have a presentation for you to understand what is the current state of the economy, where we are at, what are the weaknesses, what are the strengths, how do we actually then go about formulating the budget, where are the areas that we need to put money in, where are the places that we actually get revenue from. And so you also have a better understanding, so when we stand up in Parliament, for example, on budget day, I'll stand up in Parliament and deliver the budget. When I talk about things like foreign reserves, when I talk about operating expenditure, capital expenditure, you know, you should understand what we are talking about. Because you, of course, as educated people, there will be people in your homes, in your communities, in your families, in your areas, they may not understand, so you can also impart that knowledge to them. You, in fact, become ambassadors. So I'll take you through some of the key areas that we look at when we are formulating the budget and for you to be able to understand where we are at. I like to keep the discussions as informal as possible. Please take a deep breath, chill out, relax, so you can actually ask us questions. If you have any issues you want to state, please feel free to do so. So now we talk about economic growth. Maybe if somebody can move the chairs, please help somebody to move the chairs so we can see what's happening. Maybe can we just move this table, please? Everybody can have it. And that button. Can everybody see the screen? Yep. If you can't, just stand up on your chair and have a look. Okay. Now, we talk about economic growth. Basically, what that means is that how is the economy? Is the economy growing? Is it contracting or slowing down or not growing at all? Is it going to minus or is it growing every year? Why is it important to assess whether... Why is it important to know whether the economy is growing or not? Because if the economy is growing, that means jobs are being created. the economy is growing, that means opportunities are being created. So it's important for us to understand. Now, we have a target to grow the economy, obviously. If you can see, like if you saw 2008-2009, we had a cyclone, we had negative growth rate, 1.4% negative. Since then, the economy has been growing. You see 3%, 2%, 1.4, 4.7, 5.6. This is only the second time in Fiji's history have we had economic growth rate for 7, or now 8 consecutive years. We've never had that. Only the second time since independence, which is a good position to be in. And if you look at the growth projected rates for 2018 and 2019, they're also positive to the tune of about 3% for each of the years. If you look in the primary sector, that's agriculture. Agriculture contributed 0.31% towards the growth of the economy. But if you look at fisheries, it's very low, 0.02. If you look at forestry, it's even lower, 0.01. Can you see the thing? Then stand up if you can't see for a minute, so you know what's happening. That's in the primary sector. Industry is quite high. It's contributed about 0.56. We manufacture a lot of things in Fiji now. We manufacture clothes, we manufacture sewage water pipes, we manufacture biscuits, we make soap, all sorts of things. In part of that manufacturing, we also, what is included is the manufacturing of sugar. We make sugar from sugarcane. So that's also factored in there. The next to it is construction. Construction is also quite high, 0.33. Some of you may have noticed that there's a lot of construction going on in Fiji. A lot of people are building new homes, extending their homes, building fences, etc. And mind you, these figures, of course, are after the cyclone. Mining, 0.04. Electricity and water, 0.1. And then what we have, the services sector. The financial services sector has contributed 0.39. Then you have transport, 0.37. Wholesale and retail, 0.37 also. Accommodation, information and communication, you know, your mobile phones and all of that. That contributes towards economic growth too. And then you see education, public administration, professional services and other services. So these are the areas that contribute to growth. Now for any country, it's better for us to have what they call a broad-based growth. If we have many things contributing to economic growth. If you're only dependent on one or two things, then obviously it's problematic. So if, for example, we're only dependent on agriculture and, say, manufacturing. So if we have a cyclone and it damages all your agricultural produce and it also hits through all the factories, suddenly your economy will go down really badly. But if you are dependent on about 10 or 15 or 20 different things to contribute to economic growth, if one or two gets damaged, then obviously you can still survive on the others. So that's what you call your risk management. We try and mitigate the risks. As I was telling the tourism people, you know, tourism contributes about 37% towards our GDP. But if all your tourists or majority of the tourists are coming from only one or two countries, then you have a higher risk. Because what if the economy of those two countries aren't doing well? So less people will travel from there, you have far less people coming to Fiji. So when we say, okay, we want Chinese tourists, we want Indian tourists, we want tourists from other countries, other than just from Australia and New Zealand, we are spreading our risk. Because at the moment, 51% of all the tourists that come to Fiji are from Australia. 16% of all the tourists that come to Fiji are from New Zealand. So those two countries alone contribute nearly 70% of our arrivals, or 68-69%. So if something happens in those countries, there'll be a huge downturn in our tourism. This is why we want to have tourists from other countries. We want to grow the Australian numbers, but as a percentage, we want to reduce it. Okay, so what are the things we look at for investment? So we look at things like the value of the building permits. Remember, this is also including during cyclone winter period. So January to September last year, the value of building permits was increased by 12.7%. In other words, the number of people who made applications to put up new buildings. So that's a good indicator to see, okay, people are going to invest. The next one is the value of the work that is put in place. Again, it increased by 10.5%. Why do we look at construction? Because construction is a very good indicator of economic activity. You see this hall being built. Now, you have to have somebody who knows how to hammer the ceiling. But before they know how to hammer the ceiling, they have to go and buy the material. If there's going to be some lights put in, you have to get the electrician. If you need to get somebody else to do the painting, you have to get the painter. If you want to put up a new building, you need somebody to dig the foundation. If you hire all these different people, when you hire all these different people, they get money in their pocket. Right? They get money in their pocket, then they go and spend the money in the shop. So they may buy a carton of beer, they may buy a new car, they may buy a new dress, new clothes. When they go in and buy those things, they also pay VAT. When they pay VAT, we get the money. So we build better schools for you. We build better roads for you, but it's economic activity. When a shop gets a lot of sales, the shopkeeper will say, there's a lot of people coming to my shop, I need to hire two more assistants. It creates jobs. So this is how you need to know the connectivity within the economy. Investments of imports of investment goods, that also went up by 15.7%. In other words, these are the things that we look at, that people are buying machinery from overseas. If people are buying more graders, tractors, manufacturing plants, that means you know it's creation of jobs. There's economic activity taking place too. Government capex means what the amount of money that government is spending in terms of capital expenditure. I'll come back to that. That essentially means that the money that we are spending to build things, that's capital expenditure. New investment lending, lending for real estate and lending for construction actually went down in that period too. But of course, a lot of it is to do with the cycle of Winston. The next one, please. Consumption indicators. These are things that people buy on a daily basis. This watch that I'm wearing, this pen that this young man is holding, is not made in Fiji. This shirt may be sewn in Fiji, but the fabric comes from overseas. The steel here on this chair is not made in Fiji. It may be bent in Fiji to this shape, but it's not made in Fiji. It's imported. So when we look at consumption indicators, we're looking at things that we consume. And I'll come back to you things about not being made in Fiji. New vehicle registration in last year went up by 27.5%. Second-hand vehicle registration went up by 7.8%. In other words, more people are owning more vehicles now. You can, those of you who may travel from Nosori or travel to Nosori in the morning, you see the traffic jam. People actually talk about traffic jams in Suva and Nosori and places like that. Why? Because there are more vehicles now. And in Fiji, generally, you know, a lot of people, they see a sign of you doing well if you bought a vehicle. Oh, my son owns a vehicle now. The sign of social mobility. The people buy new vehicles. That's gone up. Lending to wholesale and retail trade has gone up by 13.2%. Imports of consumption goods, the things that I just raised. If people are buying more watches, pens, and those sorts of things, you know that people are feeling confident to spend more money. More mobile phones. There are now more than 450,000 mobile phones in use. Smart mobile phones, I should say, in use in Fiji. Today in Fiji, we have more SIM cards than actual people. Some of you I know probably have two SIM cards. Some people have dubious reasons to why they want to have two SIM cards. But these are the things that's happening. New job advertisements have gone up by 15.1%. So what the Reserve Bank of Fiji does, they look at job advertisements. They look at job advertisements in the Fiji Times. We've asked them to look at job advertisements in the Fiji Sun also. Because there are some people, some companies, even like including government, we only advertise the job advertisements in the Fiji Sun. So that in fact those figures may be even higher. PAYE collections, that's the tax you pay when you work. That has also increased by 4.9%, which means people are either getting higher salaries and or at the same time, more people are paying taxes because more jobs have been created. Personal remittances, this has increased also. In other words, people are sending more money from overseas to us. We have rugby players, we have people in the British Army, we have nurses who work overseas. We have friends and relatives who may be living in Australia, New Zealand, San Francisco, wherever they live, sending money. the people working as security guards overseas in the Middle East. So they're sending money home. When obviously they're sending money back home, it means somebody's getting it. It means they're also spending it. So that's why we look at that as favorable. Variable consumption. Even though VAT has decreased in Fiji from 15% to 9%, we've made a conscious decision, so the cost of goods to you are less. VAT collection itself has increased because more and more people are spending. So when people find things cheaper, so I might as well buy two instead of buying one. So that leads to the increase in VAT collection. New lending to private individuals decreased by 4.7%. This is the vehicle registration. Just by comparison, look at 2005. In 2005, 6,088 second-hand vehicles were registered. And 3,363 new vehicles were registered. Sorry. So 6,088 second-hand vehicles registered and 3,363. Look at that by comparison today. It was 6,088. It's now 10,152. It was 3,363 in 2005, today is 4,920 vehicles. These are the new vehicles, either the second-hand or brand-new vehicle. We, of course, like people buying brand-new vehicles. These brand-new vehicles have newer technology. Newer technology means the carbon footprint is less. In other words, we're putting less carbon out into the atmosphere. And we as Fijians, as Pacific Islanders, need to be concerned about climate change and our carbon footprint also. Retail sales survey. Retail sales have gone up. You can see they're fairly straightforward figures. The average growth is 7.1%. So you stay on it. So if you look at sales, they're looking at going down, and normally that's after a cyclone. Because people tend to hold on to money. Some people's livelihoods are affected, so have less money to spend. If you're a vegetable farmer living in Valley Road in Singatoka, if all your crops have been damaged, obviously your opportunity to spend money is reduced. You'll come back in time. Which leads me on to my next slide, which is inflation. Inflation, of course, as you can see, since 2014, we've been managing to keep it below 2%. That's the general price of goods. How much is it increasing by? You can see there's a spike. There's DC Winston, floods, and it shoots up again. A bundle of beans used to cost $5 after Winston. A small bunch of bananas, I just bought one before coming here because I didn't have lunch. So I had two bananas. I bought a bundle of that for $5. A few months back, it was like $20. Because of demand and supply. A lot of the banana plants were damaged. So obviously people still want to eat bananas, so the price goes up. Today in Fiji, in some places, a kilogram of yangona, or grog, whatever you want to call it, costs $110 a kilo. Some people, of course, they still drink it at the same level. But the fact of the matter is that the price is still high. So that contributes to the inflation levels being elevated or increased. But as you can see, it's coming down. 5.5 is going to come down because more and more goods are being produced, which will meet the demand. Now this is very important, foreign reserves. Foreign reserves is the amount of, foreign reserves is, you see, you know how I highlighted, this young man is holding a pen, he's wearing a watch, very fancy watch. You know, this is one of those lead watch. Now this watch he may buy, it may come from the person, the shopkeeper who sells it, maybe buying from Japan. When he buys it from Japan, the Japanese person is selling it to him in Japanese yen. When you buy goods from Australia, they may be selling it to you in Australian dollars. When you buy goods, certain goods are sold to you in US dollars. So you need to have that amount of foreign currency to be able to do the trading. So international banks and other people that assess us, they normally look at how much foreign reserves we have. The higher the foreign reserves, the better it is, the healthier your country is. So even when banks, when they lend you money, if the country's foreign reserves is high, they may bring the interest rate down because they know you're stable. You'll be able to repay your debts. The foreign currency is low, your level of reserves, sorry, is low, they know you're not very stable, you can flip over anytime. You see that dotted line across where we have 4.0? Normally, that's the international benchmark. You must have at least 4 months' worth of foreign reserves. It makes you healthy. That's the international benchmark. You look at how much money we had in 2005. We had only $549 million in foreign reserves. Today, we have $1.9 billion. Huge difference. And we have 5.2 months worth of foreign reserves. You see the 5.2 on top? That's the amount of foreign reserves we have to pay for 5.2 months worth of trading with our people, with the traders from offshore, the different countries. So our foreign reserves is in a healthy position. Okay, now all governments since independence, since the alliance government days, has always borrowed money. Only about two or three times in our history have we had what you call a surplus budget. There's one over there on top, you see, 0.5 in 2008. Every other time we've had a deficit, which is okay, as long as you know how to manage your deficit. Most countries, most governments in the world actually have deficit budgets. So in other words, they spend more than what they actually collect. They spend more than what they collect. So if you can see from 2009, what we've been doing is we've been trying to ensure that our deficit is low or manageable. So you can see it's going down, going down. So the smaller the line, the healthier it is. We had a cyclone. We have another big cyclone here. So we have to spend more money. So this year's budget, we have just for schools alone, we're spending $132 million just to build schools. And we have what they call a rehabilitation program for Yangona farmers, vegetable farmers, sugarcane farmers. We have to build government quarters that has been damaged, health centers, bridges, roads. There's still some villages where bridges are still being built. They are cut off. That's where the money goes. So if we did not have Cyclone Winston, we would have on the face of it been $208 million richer from the budget perspective. And this line would have been somewhere over here. So that's what we talk about when we talk about deficit. Deficit is the amount of money that you spend a year, the amount of money that you collect. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, your deficit also is affected by the fact of how much money we have as a government, how much money we collect. In 2004, the government collected $1.1 billion. In 2016-17, we are collecting $3.1 billion. The amount of money we are making as government has increased, which is a good thing. So if we are able to collect more money, then we are able to spend that money on use for the country. So the revenue collection is also good, and I'll come back to another slide to show you why it is good to collect more money from government's perspective. At the same time, we are being very stingy, we're being mamangi about things. We don't want to spend areas where we have lavish spending to ensure that we have more money to spend on the general services. What are the things that makes us collect money? What's the revenue? How do we collect revenue? So as I mentioned, see, value-added tax contributes 30% to those revenue. You see the pie. Direct taxes, which is taxes that companies pay, you pay as individuals if you are working. Customs is 21%. In other words, a lot of these goods that come into Fiji, we have a duty. You know, they talk about duty. We charge duty. We also have, I assume that excise is in there too, right? So, you know, cigarettes, alcohol, the taxes you pay on that, that all contributes towards that figure over there. We also have a service turnover tax, departure tax. When tourists come to Fiji, when they leave Fiji, they pay $200. It's built into the ticket. So we use that money to pay for things. Like, for example, now, none of you students actually pay for school fees. That never used to happen. So we obviously need the money to be able to pay for your school fees to the schools. Now we have a scholarship scheme. We have a TELS program. We need money to be able to pay for that. Just on taxes, I just wanted to highlight to you, service turnover tax is something that's applicable to what we call the high-end users. So if you watch a DVD at home, you don't pay service turnover tax. You don't pay environmental levy. But if you want to go and watch a movie at Village 6, because you're already doing that, it's a luxury item in a way. So we get you to pay VAT, service turnover tax, and environmental levy. If you go and eat at a takeaway place in Suva, normal place, you only pay VAT. You don't pay service turnover tax, you don't pay environmental levy. You want to go and eat at a fancy restaurant, you want to eat at Tico's, you want to eat at a fancy restaurant in Denrao, you'll pay environmental levy, you'll pay STP. It's what you call progressive taxation. In other words, people already earning at a higher level who will eat at a fancy place can't pay the additional tax. But a person who's going to eat at a normal takeaway place does not pay of that. So we are taking money from those people who can afford and helping it subsidized to those people who can't. Oh. Oh wow. Okay, next slide please. Okay, what we've done for you is highlighted for you the amount of money we pay in infrastructure, health, education, access to justice, social protection. Now, just to tell you the figures, $1.3 billion was spent in 2004 for these areas. Today we spent $3.6 billion, very high. How has it become high? We give you free education. Education has increased. We're giving more money for health. We also, for example, for access to justice, we now have legal aid officers throughout Fiji. In 2006, legal aid used to get only about $400,000 from government. Today, we give legal aid $5 billion. So if you are a single mother, if you're a wife who's been abandoned by the husband, you need to make maternity claims. If you have been charged by the criminal justice system for whatever offense, and you are poor and you cannot afford legal representation, legal aid will help you. If you want to draft your will, you don't know how to draft your will, they will help you. If some family member has died, you need to have what they call the probate to get access to the assets, legal aid will help you. And we have made it a mission of ours to ensure that we have legal aid not only in the towns and cities but everywhere. Small town cities, we've got it in, for example, in Nambuwalu and all those types of places, the Buni, where none of these services used to go to before. Social protection, of course, is things like social welfare payments. People who are disabled, single mothers, people below the poverty line, we give them food vouchers, we give them a cash grant also. We have had some interesting discussions around that too. We also, for example, those of you who get subsidized bus fares, we spend $21 million a year to pay for school children or school students to get access to subsidized bus fares. That's how much money we pay the private bus companies every year. And that also includes people who travel by those mini buses in certain areas that normal buses don't run. We pay for some students who live in the outer islands to get to their school on the punt, because otherwise they can't get to school. Okay, next slide please. Okay, this is very important. You see, it's called the expenditure mix. And you see the blue is the operating expenditure, brown is the capital expenditure. If you go and borrow money from the bank, and you say to the bank, I want to borrow some money because I want to take all my friends and have a big party at McDonald's, right? You'll go and have that party at McDonald's. When you wake up in the morning, the food is gone, the drinks are gone, but the debt is still there. So the point is that you don't borrow to spend on everyday stuff. You borrow to build things. If you went to the bank and say, I want to borrow money, so I want to buy a car. I want to borrow money because I want to make an additional bedroom to my house. I want to borrow money to build a new house. That's what you call your capital expenditure. The other expenditure, which is everyday expenses, is your operating expenditure. Things you need to just simply operate. In 2004, out of the 100% of money that is spent by government, 83% went into operating expenditure. In other words, the day-to-day, the civil servant salaries, the minister's salaries, the running of the motor vehicle, photocopying paper, fuel, toilet paper, whatever it was. All of that is the operating expenditure. They spent only 17% in building things of the total amount of money they spent. Today, we've reduced the 83 to 60 and we've increased the 17 to 40. In other words, we are spending more money to build things. So even if we borrow, we are only borrowing, like I said, to build things. So for the, your future is a lot more secure. So even if you have a debt, you have got something to show for the debt. I hope you get that. You can ask me questions on that if you want. Funding for roads, bridges and jetties. Just by comparison, 2004, there was only $55 million allocated. Today we have $527 million. Allocated to roads, bridges and jetties. How many of you been to Nandi recently? If you've been to Nandi recently, you see the four-lane highway that we built out of Nandi Airport going towards Namaka, Matantar and all of that. If you've noticed one thing, there's no power lines. There's no TFL lines, overhead lines. It's all underground. Why did we do that? It cost us $20 million more approximately to put the FEA lines under the ground. Why did we do that? Because it's the future-proofing. What do you call future-proofing? So, if you put the electrical cables underground, when there's a cyclone, it cannot get blown down. When we had Cyclone Winston, 6,000 kilometers of electrical lines went down. 6,000 kilometers. Sort of, this area was not affected as much as Northwest Vitilevu and all the other places. Now, assuming that we've already put up the power lines, God forbid we get another cyclone. It'll go down again, we put it up again. We get another cyclone, goes down again, we put it up again. Goes down again, put it up again. So are we wasting our money? Isn't it better to put it underground? And the other thing that used to happen in Fiji, in the good old PWD days, when they used to put water pipes, and build a road, they used to put the water pipes underneath the road. Right? They build a road here, put the water pipe underneath it. When there's a leak in the water pipe, you dig up the road. When there's a small leak in the water pipe, the water is seeping, we don't know about it, but say, hey, this road has got a lot of potholes, man. Why? Because the earth is getting softer underneath. So when your heavy trucks drive on it, you get potholes. You know, you see some roads, you see it all curves up on the edges. That's the things that used to happen. So now with the building of that road, all the water pipes were taken out and put on the side. The TFL pipes, the TFL lines were put on the side. FEA has been put on the side. So next time if something happens to the TFL line or the water line, you don't dig up the road. You don't damage your assets. That's your asset. Till today we have some of those problems. You see some places, you see somebody digging up the road. We have this Mr. Kamal Gounder, who is from the Department of Planning and Economy. We put him in all the three ports. FEA, Water, Water Authority, Fiji, FRA. Why? Because we want at least somebody to be able to coordinate things from government side. So when we build, we have to build back better. A lot of people are saying, oh, there's huge amounts of money. Yes, there is a reason behind that. Next one, please. Water and energy. Again, we have the, by comparison, $92 million in 2004, $337 million. Most of you people who are urban-based may not understand this, but there are people who live in rural areas. There may be like 20 houses in one area. So before, the power line might sort of end over there, and your area that you live with 20 other people, 20 houses maybe 2 kilometers away. So they'll say, oh, we want access to electricity. So the government used to say, well, it will cost about $240,000 to bring that line from there to your place. All the homes here must contribute 10% towards that cost. Not like the urban areas. Urban areas, you just have the electricity. In rural areas, they ask you to pay for it. And you have to contribute 10%. We reduced it from 10 to 5, and now you don't have to pay anything. And so what we call the rural electrification and grid extension. When you have more people, electricity, some of the things that you take for granted, you have lights at night to study. I just came from Navua and the school there, they don't have electricity. They don't have internet connection. This is some of the realities that we have. These are some of the things that we take for granted in towns and cities. Over here you talk about the speed of the internet. So we need to be able to understand that we have a lot of people in Fiji, or a healthy amount of people, that need that kind of basic connection. And you see we have a huge rural electrification grid extension program. Funding for education, you can see that's increased. It went up to 520 million after we introduced pre-education, including also the scholarships and the TELS program. Today we're spending over $500 million, $600 million in education. It's a lot of money. But we see it as an investment in the future. All of you, in 3-4 years' time, hopefully, so maybe slightly longer, you'll have some form of qualification. Whether it's in a technical college, whether it's a diploma, whether it is a degree, you'll all contribute to the economy. It'll help you, it'll help put you personally in a better position. So we see that as investment. We've had political events in 87, coup, etc. We lost a lot of good people, aircraft engineers, lots of people we lost. We want to rebuild that capacity, because for any country, even though the economy may be growing, if we don't come in and provide the additional resources to it, the economy can actually go down. As I was saying to the students today, if any one of us, hopefully none of you, but us older people in this room, if any one of us has a heart attack and you need an open heart surgery, there's nobody in Fiji that can carry out an open heart surgery. No Fijian doctor who can do that. Nobody. It's a tragedy. But you don't turn out an open heart surgery overnight. So this young lady does MBBS. Just because she's done an MBBS, she can't cut me open and play with my heart. She can't do that. She needs to have at least 10 to 15 years experience and specialization before she can cut me open. And what does that require? That requires training. That requires investment in her. That requires sending her overseas to be trained, get the level of exposure, work with doctors who know what they're doing. That's what we are precisely doing. So at the moment, anybody that joins the government public system as a doctor, the moment you join, we are saying to you, if you want to do postgraduate studies at FNU, go and do it, it's for free. You don't pay anything, not even a loan. You work during the day, you go and study at night. There are more and more specialists in Fiji. So it requires investment. This is why we're putting a lot of money into education. And also, sorry, just on that matter, in Fiji, generally, we have seen people not very science-based, not very science-inclined. We need more marine scientists. We need more foresters. We need more doctors, nurses, engineers, town planners, land surveyors. There's a shortage of that. A lot of people, you know, in their homes, they are taught like, you know, those things, really, you should not do it. But we want you to do that. If you have an interest, please pursue that. We're giving you proper scholarship for that. Because if we don't have enough town planners, surveyors, marine scientists, foresters, etc., how will we grow our economy? How will we look after those aspects of our economy? Next one, please. Health, again. We have, of course, you know, by comparison, what it was in 2004, $132 million towards health. Today we're spending about $244 million. We have free medicine program. We've increased the doctor's salaries last year up to about 80%. A lot of the doctors were being discouraged. They weren't necessarily being paid the right amount of salary. We increased that. A lot of the good doctors left because they felt they weren't being recognized. We've also got, for example, we're getting some specialists in at the moment to fill in the gap. So all those areas are actually being worked upon to increase the quality of lives of our people. Now, this is what I talked to you about. This is, you see this blue line here. This is the amount of money that we make, what you call operating revenue, this entire thing. Out of that, we spend this brown thing. This is the operating expenditure. And then this green part is the savings that we have from operating, what we call operating savings. You can see how much savings there was there, that's the green part. And you can see the savings now. Lot more savings now. So we have a lot more savings, it gives us the opportunity to spend a bit more. And it means that when we borrow, we only borrow to build. We don't borrow for everyday expenditure. Next slide, please. Okay, government debt. I know there's a lot of people who talk about government debt without necessarily knowing what they're talking about. The main thing to look at is this line here. It's what we call debt to GDP ratio. Let me explain it to you. If, for example, we as a country are making $100 as a country, we then go and borrow $20. What percentage is $20 of $100? Sorry? 20%. Okay? You all agree? 20%. So, you're borrowing $20, but your debt that you, the loan that you borrow is 20% of your overall income. Debt to GDP ratio, 20%. Now, assuming you make $500. As opposed to making $100, you make $500. And then instead of borrowing $20, you borrow $50. So you borrowed more, what we call in nominal terms, you borrowed more. From 20, you went up to 50. But there's a percentage of your overall GDP, overall revenue, what's 50 or $500? 10%. Okay? So even though it's increased from 20 to 50, it's decreased in overall of what you are making. That's what we call the debt to GDP ratio. So you can see we have a concerted effort to reduce our debt to GDP ratio. We were going down, and then we went up. Why did we go up? Winston. We borrowed an additional $208 million just to build the schools and all the other things that I talked about. So if actually Winston had not happened, this line would have kept on going down. So this is why we don't like cyclones. This is why we don't like this kind of natural disasters. Apart from it causing death, we lost 44 Fijian lives. We lost 44 Fijian lives. Apart from that, it also creates a great economic loss for us. And the goal for us as a government is that we need to future-proof our economy. It doesn't come cheap, it costs money. Next slide, please. So, this is the last page, ladies and gentlemen. So the economy is expected to grow, 8 years of consecutive growth, the favorable prospects for medium term. We've got increased private sector investment optimism, a lot of private sector people you see, a lot of factories being built, a lot of new investments are taking place. We also have, like I said, we are very stingy about things. We're managing our finances well, and we've got a sustainable debt position. We have a very high level of capital expenditure. In other words, we are building more and more in terms of our expenditure. Broad-based growth, foreign reserves are comfortable, and inflation is stabilized below 3%. Before I open up the floor, and please feel free to ask any questions or any suggestions, I'd just like to explain to you the process. As I said, we're having the consultations the next few days in other places. And then the permanent secretary will meet all the other permanent secretaries of all the other ministries. And they have a face-to-face meeting. So each permanent secretary, say for education, will come along and say, look, we think that this is how much money we need, and we need this money because of X, Y, Z. So then they talk about it, they negotiate it, she goes through it with a fine-tooth comb, she may cut down some expenditure saying this is not necessary, you can do it next year. She does it with all the ministries. We then after that have another round of public consultations in other areas that we won't have covered. And then we meet up again, so this time around we'll meet with the ministers. So the ministers will come with their permanent secretaries and I'll be there with the PS and we again talk about budget. And then we finalize the budget. So on budget day, and as you know we started this new initiative last year where we made the budget announcement at night time. The reason why we're doing that is we want more and more of you to be able to listen to it. During the day you'll be at school. If you come home at 7 p.m. whilst you're having the dinner, we'll deliver the budget. Just for you to think. So we'll deliver the budget. By law, when I stand up and deliver the budget, there must be 1 week's gap, at least 6 days gap, before the budget is presented to Parliament again for debate. But then you see the opposition and other people that will stand up and say, oh, in Ministry of Education, in the government schools division, you are giving this much money for photocopying. Why are you doing this? Why have you reduced it? Why have you increased it? You go line by line, every single item. And then we vote on it, line by line. Each program, what they call programs and activities. And then the budget gets passed. The budget then becomes applicable from the 1st of August, because our financial year now is from 1st of August to 31 July the following year. So this is why the budget is now called, so this year's budget is called the budget of 2016-2017. The budget we'll be delivering will be budget of 2017-2018. Now, nothing in the budget gets passed or gets into effect until Parliament passes it, except one thing. The day that we stand up and deliver the budget that evening, if we announce any increase in any tariff, any duty, any excise duty, it becomes applicable from midnight of that night. So assuming we stand up at 7 p.m. on a Friday and deliver the budget, and we say the duty on cigarettes and alcohol is going up, the duty on something is going down, soon as the clock strikes midnight, it comes into effect. The tariffs need to be treated that way. That's the difference. But everything else, all the policies, has to get approved by Parliament. Okay, so that's the process. I've done a lot of talking. We'll open up the floor. You guys aren't as laughing as much at my joke as the other people in Nauvoo did. I don't know. But please feel free and ask any questions. Don't be shy of your teachers.